Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Brendan Teeling, and on behalf of Dublin City Council, great pleasure to welcome you to the Dublin Festival of History. I'd like to welcome all of you who are here with us in person, and those of you who are watching online. We appreciate your support. I'd also like to welcome our ISL interpreters, Vanessa and Cormac. I hope they appreciate that I have slowed down today. I'm determined not to go too fast. So this is the first session, the second day of our big weekend, and we have a great lineup for you today, and we're delighted to be starting off with such a distinguished speaker. Just to say, there will be time for questions at the end, and Conor will be happy to sign copies of his book. Conor Brady is former editor of the Irish Times and former member of the Garda Ombudsman Commission. He's an honorary professor of journalism at NUI Galway. And also, for any budding civil servants out there, he's head of TLAC, the top level appointments commission. So just be careful what you say, because canvassing will disqualify, as we all know. Conor's book is that he's here to talk about this morning was published back in April, Guardians of the Peace, the Early Years of the Irish Police Force. So please welcome Conor Brady. Thanks, Conor.
Thank you, Brendan, and thank you for the introductory words, kind words. Good morning, everybody. Nice to see you. Sometimes you fear that you're going to be facing an empty room here in a situation like this, being first act on in the morning. But, it's a great pleasure to be here, and I'm very grateful to Dublin City Libraries and the Dublin Festival of History for inviting me. For me, this is a sort of, I suppose it's a labor of love. This is a topic I've been engaged in really since my teenage years. So maybe I should start by explaining just a little bit about how I came to this topic. As Brendan has said, I spent all of my life, really most of my life anyway, my working life, as a journalist and newspaper editor, and if any of you have ever had recourse to the law over anything that's been published in the Irish Times, you've probably met me across a crowded courtroom floor, so I hope there aren't anybody here that I have to refer to as the plaintiff. I was editor of the Irish Times for quite a few years and did a few other jobs in journalism as well. But in parallel with that, I've had a lifelong interest in policing history. I suppose we are what we have come from. My father died when I was quite young. He was one of the first superintendents in the founding of the Free State. He had been a teacher, was involved in the Irish Volunteers, lost his teaching job because of his involvement in the Volunteers. And when the War of Independence was over, he was invited to throw in his lot with the newly formed Civic Guards, as they were called. And 23 years of age, he found himself as a young superintendent assigned down to North Clare without a day's training, without any experience. He had half a uniform. And that's the way it was back in at the foundation. So, as I say, he died when I was 12, and I never really knew him as an adult, but I was always interested in what he did and his life and the influences that shaped his life. And when I went to UCD and left UCD, went to the Irish Times, as a young trainee reporter straight out of college, Douglas Gage was the editor at the time, and he brought me into the office and he said, "So, what are you interested in?" And I said, "Student politics, mostly, journalism, current affairs." And he kind of wiped his brow and he said, "Jesus, not another fellow who wants to be a political correspondent." And he said, "Do you know anything about anything else?" And I said, "I don't really think so. Medieval monasticism is one of my subjects in college." He said, "There isn't much room for that," he said, in the paper at the moment. So he said, "What did your father do?" And I said, "The guards," he said, "are in revolt at the moment. Nobody knows anything about them. None of this crowd out here in the newsroom know anything about the guards. So why don't you start writing in that area?" Some of you here, if I judge correctly, probably would be old enough to remember that in the late 60s, there was a lot of trouble in the guards, a lot of unhappiness. The old founding generations were going, and the new ones were coming in, and they weren't making a very good job of adapting to a changing Ireland. So I started writing in that area, and I found that there was nobody else in it, and I found that the guards were very receptive to the idea of having somebody listen to their story. And out of that was born the idea. I realized there was no history of the guards. Not a syllable had been written to commemorate to chronicle this quite extraordinary story of the creation of an unarmed police service in a newly founded state, which was coming out of a maelstrom of violence. So I had the opportunity to take my postgraduate, my master's, and I went to Brian Farrell was my supervisor in UCD, and I went to Farrell and I said, Brian, could I do my thesis on the founding of the police force, the guards? And he said, yeah, broaden it out. He said, look at the whole question of law enforcement in the Free State, the re-establishment of the justice system in the Free State. And out of that came my thesis, and out of my thesis came Guardians of the Peace. So this has just been published now, thanks to the cooperation and the goodwill and the enthusiasm of New Ireland Books. But it was originally published in 1972 for the 50th anniversary of the founding of the force. It's different this time in that Drew Harris, the current commissioner, has written a very cogent and very relevant introduction to it, and basically linking the values which imbued the first force in the 20s with the values that are required of police officers in the 21st century. I mean, the same values of integrity and resilience and tolerance, energy, and a sense of public service. They were there in the 1922. They're there still in 2022. So I decided to write the book. It is a warts and all story. It is by no means a dewy-eyed illusion, I hope, of what I would still maintain was a very significant, element in the building of a new state from 1922 onward. But it has been deeply flawed in many ways. It has gone through its nightmares. And it has had to recover from manipulation, political interference, internal corruption at times, and at the same time get on to do what it's sworn by oath to do on behalf of the people of Ireland. So I'm going to talk for about maybe 20, 25 minutes about the about that story, about how it evolved, some of the highlights of it. And we'll take a little time for questions at the end if people want me to amplify anything or people have questions to ask. But I thought maybe I should start by putting the policing of the state in a historical context. Some of you may have been familiar with a very distinguished British sociologist of the 1960s called Ben Whittaker. Whittaker was one of the early sociologists who understood that it was necessary to measure the performance of the police. And Whittaker developed this thesis that you may judge the political health of a society and the social health of any community by the way its police are regulated and by the way its police perform and by the way its police behave themselves. And, you know, it is a really accurate litmus test of any society. And you see it time and again. It's illustrated here. It's been illustrated in Europe. It's been illustrated in the United States, particularly. I think there's a particularly close barometrical relationship between social tensions and the way the police behave in the United States. So when you're talking about police history, I would contend you're not just talking about the history of a group of men and women who go around in blue and white cars. You're actually looking into a microcosm of how a society develops and what its values are. It's a test that in my experience has never failed. Police are a very accurate reflection of what a society is about. There is not a single instance recorded in history of a police force leading a revolution. They're not revolutionaries. They're never on the leading edge of change. They follow change and they reflect change in society. And they reflect current values and they express current values and they enforce current values. There was a famous police chief in Chicago many years ago, Chief O'Neill, whose instructions to police was, get out in the streets and enforce the Ten Commandments. And that was reflective, I suppose, of that era. But a little bit about the background of policing. We're celebrating the centenary of the Garda, which is founded in 1922. We're not celebrating the founding of the Irish Constabulary, which is actually, if we were celebrating it, it would be 200 years, 1822, when the Irish Constabulary, later to be the Royal Irish Constabulary, was established by Thomas Drummond. We're probably won't be marking this the bicentenary either of the Dublin Metropolitan Police, but the Dublin Metropolitan Police were founded in 1837 on the model that Sir Robert Peel built the London Metropolitan Police, the famous London Bobbies. But what you had in Ireland was two distinct police services and two distinct police traditions. And it's interesting to watch how they evolved and came together to give us what we have today. The Irish Constabulary, or the Royal Irish Constabulary as it became, was a classic colonial police force. It was officered by the sons of the gentry, the sons of the aristocracy, the senior ranks from district inspector, which would be superintendent now up, were all filled by the younger sons, usually, of Protestant aristocratic families. Many of them would have, for the standards of the time, would have had very extensive education, a lot of Oxbridge men, a lot of Trinity men, and a lot of people with senior experience in the military. So in every county, you would have a county inspector who would probably be from the landed gentry or from a privileged ascendancy background. Two or three district inspectors who would be from the same kind of background and would be aspiring to promotion. And then you would have maybe 10 or 12 stations with a couple of hundred head constables, sergeants, and constables. They were almost always Roman Catholic, drawn from the agricultural classes. They did not aspire to promotion beyond the rank of head constable, which would be broadly equivalent to an inspector in the present structure of the police. So you had a police system which was clearly divided by class, by religion, by political loyalty, and by the limitations of their ambitions. This model, the Irish Constabulary model, was initially established on a county basis, then on a regional basis, and then finally on an all-Ireland basis, all 32 counties, with headquarters at the depot in the Phoenix Park, where, of course, the Garda's headquarters still resides today. The difference between what the policing system was, the policing system in rural Ireland and the policing system in rural England could not have been greater, because the constabulary, the Irish constabulary, were armed. Every man had a carbine, a bayonet, a revolver, as well as the standard baton. There were backup ammunition and firearms in the stations, the barracks, as they were called, totally different from the rest of policing in these islands, where the police were unarmed, where they lived not in barracks but in stations. They had a different nomenclature. There was constable, sergeant, inspector, superintendent, chief superintendent, head constable, assistant constable. The Royal Irish Constabulary lived in barracks. They rarely lived out among the community, certainly until much later years. And they were set apart, really, from the community in which they worked. Although many of them did integrate, they married locally. A lot of them became active in the early GAA, for example. A lot of them, because they were from the west of Ireland and the south of Ireland, would have been native Irish speakers, so they became very active in the Gaelic League. To do any of those things, of course, was career death for them. As soon as a RIC man became involved with the local Gaelic football club, he was gone. That was it. He would usually be transferred at his own expense to some other part of the country. So you had this big cultural clash. Now, that was for the area outside of Dublin. Within Dublin itself, it was a totally different story. The Dublin Metropolitan Police, which was established in 1837, was exactly the same as the police of Liverpool, or the police of Manchester, or the police of London. They didn't live in barracks, they lived at home. They didn't have a split-level entry system. Everybody started at the rank of constable, and the lowliest constable could aspire to the rank of chief superintendent. And one celebrated detective inspector Mallon, John Mallon, who was famous for apprehending the Invincibles after the Phoenix Park murders. Mallon, who was the son of a Catholic small farmer from County Armagh, rose to the exalted rank of assistant commissioner. Now, that would never have happened in the Royal Irish Constabulary. The RIC and the DMP regarded each other as two quite separate civilizations. There are stories told of on the boundaries of Dublin City and Dublin County, where the armed RIC patrol would meet the unarmed DMP patrol, and it was like Martians talking to Venusians. They just did not know what it was all about. And they went back to their respective barracks, having exchanged whatever information they could. There was no transference between the two forces. The DMP, of course, was unarmed, apart from a small detective branch in Dublin Castle. The interesting thing is that the Dublin Metropolitan Police was divided, as were the police forces of the English and Scottish cities and Welsh cities, on a divisional basis, A, B, C, D, E, and F. To this day, the guards' divisions in Dublin mirror precisely the A, B, C, D, E, F that the DMP had from 1837. The A is Kevin Street, Kilmainham, made famous by James Joyce, or in the words of Stephen Dedalus, he says, "Them crowd down in the A, they'd swear perjury through the bottom of a tin bucket." The B always had the tallest men, and it still has, and the tallest women. And the idea there was that when the monarch came to town, or when the viceroy was in town, he or she needed protection, so you put tall people around them. And those men were drawn from the B. The C were the tough men on the north side of the city. They policed Monto and all of that area up around there. The D was the Bridewell, and they were basically responsible for looking after the forecourts and the courts of law. The E and the F, they were the choice divisions. E was Donnybrook, Rathmines, Ranelagh, leafy suburbs. The F, to go to the F was to be brought to heaven and earth. You were in Dunleary, Kill of the Grange, and Dalkey. Although Dalkey was for a long time regarded as a punishment station. And if you went to Dalkey, it was the view was taken that you lived less expensively and therefore you got less pay. I think they got 2 shillings a week less than a constable who would be working in the city. But interestingly enough, 1922, the RIC, of course, had been decimated in the War of Independence. Nearly 600 of them had been killed, and that I'm not including members of the auxiliary division there. Their morale was broken. A lot of them they got a really good severance package. A lot of them took the severance package and went off. A lot of them went north to the Royal Ulster Constabulary, which of course simply continued. It was the RSC under a different name. So a lot of them went north to the RUC, which basically meant a change of cap badge, and that was it. A lot of them emigrated to Palestine, and they formed the backbone of the Palestine police. A lot of them went to Canada, and a big proportion of them became Mounties. Some of them went to America, not too many went to the United States. Canada, Australia, New Zealand was where they went, and they made new lives there. A very small number of RSC men joined the Guards, fewer than 100. And nearly all of them were men who had been secretly on Michael Collins' payroll. People like David Nelligan and Ned Broy, Johnny McNamara, they were all on Collins' payroll within the police. They moved into the Guards. The rank and file of the Guards did not like them, and they challenged very often Collins' assertion that these men were actually on the side of the Republic, on the side of the revolution. I'm not sure Collins was right about all of them. I think some of them, and I interviewed a lot of them for this book, I think a lot of them didn't know what side they were on. I remember one particular individual, and he showed me proudly his three pension slips, one from the Dublin Metropolitan Police, one from the National Army, and a third one, he said, and this is the sweetest of all, and it was from Her Majesty's Secret Service. There is a myth that the Guards were largely populated by former RSC people. That is not true. They weren't. There was fewer than 100. And of that 100 that joined, the vast majority were gone within a couple of years. What did happen, however, was that the Royal Irish Constabulary was a supremely well-organized, well-disciplined, well-led, well-trained, well-equipped police organization. And right through the 19th century, as the British Empire extended into Africa and parts of the Caribbean and other far-flung places, India, Pakistan, as we now know them, they needed a police system for them. They took the police system straight out of the Phoenix Park depot. And every year, dozens of senior RSC men would apply for jobs in Canada, in India, in Pakistan, as we now call it, in Nigeria, South Africa. So you could be a district inspector in the Royal Irish Constabulary in Ireland. You apply for one of these jobs, and you could become a commissioner or a district commissioner in one of the colonies overseas, with a huge increase, of course, in income. And what you brought was your expertise, your knowledge. You went out basically as a white officer to lead constables who were generally always raised from the indigenous population. And you brought with you all of the skills that you had learned in keeping the native Irish under control, whether it was in the west of Ireland or the south of the Midlands or wherever. So Collins recognised, and the other members of the provisional government actually, and Mulcahy had a very important role in this, they recognised that the RSC was a formidable organisation. So they wanted the new police force of the new Free State to reflect that. The idea that the new police force should be unarmed never occurred to them. It was going to be given new uniforms. You got rid of the old bottle green of the Royal Irish Constabulary, and you put in new blue uniforms to make them look like English bobbies. And you changed the nomenclature of the rank system. So you did away with the district inspectors and the county inspectors, and you called them superintendents and chief superintendents. The Inspector General of the Royal Irish Constabulary was replaced by a commissioner, the first commissioner being Michael Staines, the second commissioner being Owen O'Duffy. But the structure remained exactly the same. Senior officers from superintendent upward were appointed directly by central government. They reported directly through to the commissioner, who reported through to the secretary of the Department of Justice, who now took the place of the Assistant Chief Secretary for Home Affairs in Dublin Castle, and they in turn reported through to the government. So the structure of governance was identical. A centralized police force, directly under government control, totally different from what operated in England and Wales and Scotland, where police forces were controlled by locally elected committees. And there was a famous exchange in the Dáil when the leader of the Labour Party, Tom Johnson, asked Kevin O'Higgins, who was the Minister for Home Affairs, whether he thought it would be a good thing for there to be police committees around the country who would be able to liaise with and work with the officers of the newly formed police force. And O'Higgins famously retorted that he would not entertain Deputy Johnson's suggestion, as he would not have superintendents and chief superintendents of the Garda Síochána reporting to the butcher, the baker, and the candlestick maker in every regional town in the country. So that one went out. So what you got in 1922 was a structure modelled totally on the old Royal Irish Constabulary, headquartered in the depot in the same way as the Royal Irish Constabulary had been. The divisional structures, basically usually two small counties or one big county, was simply passed over and became, instead of being an RIC division, became a Civic Guard division. And the guards were to be sent out armed initially with the short issue Webley 38 revolver and with every station to have a locker of Lee Enfield rifles with ammunition. And everybody thought this was just going to work as it should work. It didn't work, of course, like that, because what happened was the guards who were 90% of the early recruits were ex-IRA men, and nearly 40% of them were column men. They had been out on the hills, they'd been out, they were fighting men. They were accustomed to firearms. They were trained in firearms. They were trained in combat. They did not like the idea of the discipline that was being imposed upon them in the newly formed police force by sergeants and inspectors who were former RIC men. They didn't see why they should be in the ranks. They felt they should have the promotional jobs and that the RIC men should have gone to Palestine or wherever. So, having moved from one training center to another, the depot wasn't available yet, the RIC were still there. The guards started in Ship Street, then they went to the RDS, then they went to Kildare, what later became the artillery barracks in Kildare. It's now a direct provision center, I understand. But there they revolted, and they insisted that the RIC men be got rid of. A number of them raided the armory and took off with a lot of weaponry to join the anti-treaty forces. The commissioner, Staines and his senior staff were forced out the gate at gunpoint, and the guards elected a new commissioner, a man called Paddy Brennan, who was an IRA leader from County Clare. So you now had the immovable force meeting the unstoppable force meeting the immovable object. The government couldn't tolerate this, of course. So they sent down a couple of civil servants, and they sent down Owen O'Duffy as the new commissioner. The IRA men liked O'Duffy. He was a fighting man, a military man. And O'Duffy said to them, "We understand your grievances. We're going to give you your back pay, and we're going to bring you to a proper barracks. So tomorrow morning, every man is to take his bedroll and his belongings, put your weapons into the truck under the charge of the armourer, and we are going to our new headquarters, which is going to be at Collinstown, which is now Dublin Airport." So the lads thought that was great. They all went on the lash that night, and they drank until the small hours in the pubs in Kildare. Most of them made their way safely back to barracks, got a few hours sleep, got into the trucks in the morning, headed off to Collinstown, while the lorries containing the rifles and the revolvers and the Mills bombs went to Beggar's Bush Barracks in Dublin. They paraded the following morning in Collinstown. Some of them had uniforms, some hadn't, and Owen O'Duffy came out in front of them, along with Kevin O'Higgins, and said, gentlemen, you are now members of the unarmed civic guard, and you are going to your stations, and by force of moral authority, you shall subdue the people and bring the country back to conditions of peacefulness, tranquility, and prosperity. Most of them thought the man was mad. A lot of them walked off the square straight away. They weren't having anything to do with this. The idea of going down into mad places around the country without your firearms, without your weapons, was unthinkable. But a lot of them left. Meantime, they started a new recruitment, and a lot of the early ones went out. About 1,800 men had been recruited at this stage. About 1,000 of those left. Only 800 stayed on. They were actually, sometimes you would meet guards when I was interviewing who had two registered numbers. One was they registered in the first tranche, then they were deregistered and they registered again. And you could almost tell to the hour when a man joined by his registered number. But they decided they'd get on with it. The men who came in on the second wave, they were nearly all IRA still. But they were not as battle-hardened. They weren't column men. They were messengers, and they were, some of them had combat experience, but for the most part, they weren't soldiers. So they took more easily to a police role. O'Duffy was an extraordinary character. He did manage to pull off this unarmed Garda thing, and he was ably assisted by Kevin O'Higgins in this. They got the newspapers on side, and the newspaper editorials were all full of this thing, that this was a hugely civilized thing to do, that the people of Ireland could now show that they were, by nature, they were a peace-loving people, a law-abiding people, that they weren't, as they were being portrayed in the British press in particular, as arsonists and bombers. So the unarmed guards went out into the country, and the words are often quoted, but they have almost become cliched, but they are actually, they were relevant. Before he departed, the first commissioner, Staines, made a valedictory address on the depot square, and he said to the recruits, he said, the civic guard will prevail not by force of arms or by virtue of numbers, but by their moral authority as the servants of the people. And for the most part, the guards were, they weren't, very few of them would have had extensive education in the formal sense, but they were intelligent men, and they knew what he was saying, and they understood the idealism of it. A lot of them didn't, but there was enough of them who did, and enough of them who felt sufficient pride, and who had a sufficient sense of public service, and a sense of patriotism to go out and do it. And the things that happened over those early years were quite extraordinary. They went in small groups of 10 or 15 or 5 or sometimes even 3 into small stations. And there were innumerable instances in which they did prevail by moral force. And they stood up to men who had guns. Their barracks were raided in the night. They were burned out. They were turned out on the side of the street. They were beaten up. Some of them were shot. There were 3 deaths. One of the deaths was in my father's district in North Clare, where the guards had come down very heavily on potsheen making, which was on an industrial scale. And there was a young guard shot on Christmas Eve, 1925, in an ambush. The potsheen crowd thought that they could intimidate the guards, so they reckoned that if they shot one, everything would be okay. But of course, it didn't work like that. What happened was the place was flooded. Not just by guards, but by military as well. So by 1925, the country had pretty well been settled. The guards had established themselves over 19 divisions outside of Dublin. There was still the Dublin Metropolitan Police had been allowed to continue, but there were problems in certain areas of the country, and in particular, in Clare and in Kerry and in Leitrim. And there were a lot of diehard Republicans in those areas who, although the IRA had called a ceasefire and De Valera had given the famous dump arms order, they continued, and gradually a lot of them morphed into simply criminal bands. Leitrim was particularly bad. There were a lot of killings in Leitrim. Jurors were shot. Two guards were shot. Witnesses in court cases disappeared. And the upshot of it was that O'Duffy, who was then commissioner, and Nelligan, who was the head of special branch, said, or the head of crime investigation, said, look, this can't go on. We do need to toughen up here. So interestingly enough, the first special branch units were formed. And I think most people would be surprised in this day and age to realize that special branch was actually formed to deal with problems in County Leitrim. And the way they did it was clever. They decided to amalgamate the Dublin Metropolitan Police and the Civic Guard into one unified Garda Síochána. Detectives of the Dublin Metropolitan Police who carried firearms were inducted into the Garda Síochána and were given a warrant to operate all over the state, not just in Dublin. So now you had a situation where armed guards, detectives, could travel throughout the country while preserving the idea of the unarmed civic guard. And the first detachments of these were sent to Leitrim in 1925. 24 men under a fellow called Finan O'Driscoll, who had been in Oriel House, which was Collins' CID. They went to Leitrim. They had two Ford motor cars. They had six Thompson submachine guns. Every man had a rifle, and every man had a Webley 45, and every car had a box of Mills bombs. They couldn't get accommodation anywhere. Nobody would let them in. They didn't want to go into the Garda station, so the Dáil had to pass special legislation, the Garda Síochána Temporary Acquisition of Premises Act, 1925, to allow them to acquire premises. And I remember David Nelligan telling me, he said, I had a bad overdraft with the Ulster Bank, but he said, I went into the Ulster Bank in Drumshanbo, and there was a little orange man of a minister in there. And I put my warrant on the table and I said to him, out you get. And he said, it took great satisfaction seeing that fellow waddle out the door. And my lads came in. So, I say it's a little known fact that it started in 1925. But that's the sort of the dramatic story at the beginning. Things moved up. Obviously, there were significant developments. 1932, when De Valera came to power, he got rid of O'Duffy, he got rid of Nelligan, he got rid of a lot of the special branch people, brought in a lot of Fianna Fáil people into the guards. They called them the Broy Harriers. The Broy Harriers ultimately merged very successfully with the original Cumann an Gael guards. And it was actually a very good thing, because when the war broke out in 39 and the IRA went into league with Nazi Germany, the Garda needed all the intelligence they had on the IRA. And of course, having men in there who had been Fianna Fáil IRA persuasion meant that their intelligence was really far better than if they had not had that intake. So that's the story of the early years. That brought me up to, in this one, it brought me up to 1972. There were some things happened. The war, obviously, the wartime experience for the guards was searing. They were badly equipped. They were aging. They weren't sure what their role would be if there was to be a German invasion. I do remember talking to some of them, and some of the senior members who had served in the emergency years, as it was called, and they basically, their instructions were, if the Germans come in and if the Germans take over, you have to work with the Germans. You're here, you are the civil power, you will have to cooperate with them. It wasn't a very cheerful prospect. Thankfully, it never came to that. The years after the war then were fairly quiet. There was hardly any crime. There was many years when there wouldn't have been a single murder reported in the state. And the guards grew old and grey and tired. And that brings us back then to the 1960s, as I said, when things really reached crisis point, because here you had an old and tired organisation facing into troubles in the north of Ireland, the first stirrings of organised crime here in the state, the first hint of the drugs problem. So the 60s, the 70s and the 80s were not good years, really, for the guards. But a gradual process of recovery, I think, got underway. We could stay here all day and talk about how much they've recovered and how well they are now and otherwise, but that's a whole different story. So maybe on that point I'll finish it. It's a tour to Oryzon. I know I've thrown a lot of information out there, but if there's anything in what I've said that anybody would like me to elaborate on, or if there's any questions, I'd be very happy to take them. Sorry, there's a microphone on the way.
Sorry. Is it true that one of the commissioners of the guards, when the band Garda were introduced, looked for ladies that weren't, well, didn't want to go to the Rota Tralee? Is that right?
Not quite, no. It was actually a member of the Dáil, and I will refrain from naming him, who said he welcomed the appointment of women to the guards. He didn't think they should be too good looking, though. He said, I'm not saying they should be horse-faced. This is the exact words he said. But he said, we wouldn't want to have to lose them to marriage after all that training we put into them. Sorry, the gentleman here in front.
Basically, I have two questions. I get the impression, and I didn't know this, that the DMP was not disestablished in 1922. And the other one is, you will know who Peter Berry was.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just wondering, did you ever encounter him?
Indeed. No, the DMP continued until 1925. They removed the commissioner and they put in a fellow called Murphy, an Irishman from RD in County Louth as commissioner, former army officer, very distinguished army officer. And he remained as commissioner until 1925 of the Dublin Metropolitan Police. Then they merged with the Guards in 1925 and he was appointed as a deputy commissioner of the Guards. Peter Berry, yeah, Peter Berry was the Secretary of the Department of Justice for a long, long, long time. And I never met him, I have to say, but I did speak to him on the phone many times. He was the J. Edgar Hoover, if you like, of his time. And he had his own personal firearm issued to himself. He took it upon himself to be Chief of National Security. He was a very formidable figure. In the end, he was the central figure in the arms crisis of the 1970s, and he actually probably redeemed himself by acting quite honourably at that point. But there would be many people who would have a different view.
Thank you very much, Conor. Most interesting. I have a question which was posed in 40 years ago, but you might be able to answer it. My background is I'm from Derry, my wife's from Derry. Both her grandfathers, one from Mayo, one from Donegal, both her grandfathers were in the RIC. Now, my wife and I met in UCD. We lived in London for a while, Paris for a while, came back to Dublin. We moved to Rathmines in the early 80s. And a number of her kind neighbours said, look, come in, have a cup of coffee and meet your new neighbours. So that was fine. In passing, and I have no idea how it happened, she happened to say, both my grandfathers were in the RIC. And one of the ladies present said, that's nothing I would be boasting about. Now, my question is, why on earth did the RIC have such a bad rap?
Well, that's a very profound question, and it has echoes still today. And a couple of years back, as you saw, when they tried to honour the service of the RIC, there were a lot of angry voices raised about it. They were the subject. I mean, let's face it, they did control Ireland for Britain for nearly 100 years. They were the strong right hand of Dublin Castle. And while they were at one level integrated with the community and accepted by the community, when the chips were down, you know, those of them who stayed in the RIC came to be regarded as the enemies of the revolution. And the enemies of the revolution rarely do well when the revolution is over. So that's the best answer I can give on that one.
Conjecture, but if the Gardaí hadn't revolted, as you outlined, do you think that we would have had and still have an armed Garda force?
As a historian, one is always wary of what ifs. If Brian Brew had a good century after the Battle of Clontarf, he'd be alive today. I think it's probable that they would have, yes, we would have an armed force today. I think it was the luck of history, the fluke of history, and you know, it's a wonderfully valuable thing to have. And interestingly enough, I was talking to a very senior person in the tourist industry recently, and they've conducted a big survey of why people like to come to Ireland. One of the reasons in there, they probed them very deeply, and one of the things in there they get again and again and again and again is the fact, and your police force don't carry guns. We think this is amazing. And particularly, I suppose, if they went to certain suburbs of Dublin in the weekends and they see that they're not carrying guns out there, or suburbs of Limerick, they would be even more surprised. But it is a valuable thing, and it very often isn't acknowledged. But to answer your question, who knows? There's a gentleman. Sorry, there's two here, yeah. Will we take this man here first? Yes.
I was wondering, you were saying in 1922, a lot of the RIC went to join the RUC.
Yes.
So would we then have had a majority of Catholic police in the RUC for once?
It's a very good point, and you're right. There was a huge number of Catholics in the lower ranks of the Royal Ulster Constabulary when it was established in the 1920s. They didn't get into the upper ranks. And if you just go through the lists of the upper ranks of the RUC in the 20s and the 30s, you can tell from the names and you can tell from where they went to school that they weren't Roman Catholics. A lot of the RIC men who left here, joined the RUC, they would have had the benefit of the extended service. They were given an additional 14-year service for pensionable purposes. So if they served another 4 or 5 years in the RUC, they could move out then with a full pension. So over time then the RUC became Protestantized, I suppose, if you want. Although there were still a significant minority of Roman Catholics in the RUC right up to the Troubles. And I remember as a young reporter for the Irish Times covering the rioting in Derry in the early 70s, and the chief superintendent there was Frank Lagan, who was a Roman Catholic.
Sorry. Just a question related to the Royal Irish Constabulary. So a number of them went off and worked in other parts of the Commonwealth to, you know, set up police forces. With the smooth transition to the Garda Síochána, was there any other kind of countries that came to like view and try to mirror exactly what we did here in that kind of transition away from like when they got their independence?
I don't believe that there are any other post-colonial countries where they abandoned the idea of an armed gendarmerie type police and replaced it with an unarmed civil police. To some degree, they got to that in New Zealand. A lot of the New Zealand police now work routinely without firearms. So police in New Zealand who are on outdoor patrol duty or traffic duty, or that they rarely carry firearms. But I'm not aware that there's anybody else who took that decision. Probably the political circumstances that we had here weren't replicated elsewhere, you know.
How many people joined the Broy Harriers?
I think probably about 500 ultimately. Now, they didn't all come in at once. The first couple of hundred of them were recruited on a Tuesday morning in 1932, when O'Duffy proposed to do a march on Leinster House, and the Fianna Fáil government, De Valera government, reckoned that they were going to have to just bring in reinforcements quickly. They went down to the first batch of Broy Harriers came from two places. They came from the Dublin Port and Docks Board. They were basically men who worked in the docks, Fianna Fáil supporters, and men who worked in Cleary's department store. So I think they got about 50 men out of Cleary's, and they got about 30 men out of the docks. And they sent them up in two trucks to the Lower Castle Yard, and every man was given a badge and a Webley 45 and a Bible and told to raise his right hand, and then there were guards.
That's training.
Sorry, the gentleman here in front of me. It's coming.
On the initial formation of the guards, was it the case that each IRA unit nominated a member to join?
That is true. And some would say that accounted for the poor quality of many of the recruits. Because if you were an IRA commander, we'll say in West Cork, and you're told Collins wants six fellas above in Dublin, you weren't going to send him your best six men. You looked around and you said, right, there's Murphy the troublemaker and O'Driscoll another troublemaker. I'm sure they'd be grand. So they put them on the train to Dublin. Collins himself had a very poor opinion of the Republican police, as they were called. The IRA had this thing called the Republican police, as you'll probably know. They were an ad hoc kind of an operation. Collins had a very poor view of them. He did not rate them very highly. And inevitably, you can understand it, you're an IRA commander in, say, Longford or Kerry or someplace. You're trying to fight the Black and Tans, and you're trying to fight the auxiliaries, and you're trying to inflict as many casualties as you can. You're going to put your best men into the firing line, and you're going to put your less formidable people back behind the line.
But that suggests this happened before the ceasefire.
That's a good question. You have me there. I don't know. I don't know at what stage that went out. I think it was probably after the ceasefire. But the ceasefire is, you know, after the truce. I mean, the truce of ears, as they were called, it was much more a truce in some places than in others, you know. And just because the truce had been declared, a local IRA commander wasn't going
to take from that.
Yeah, you know, it's a good point. Yeah. But it's an interesting question, yeah.
Thanks.
That much being said, I mean, I should add, a lot of them came up, and I remember interviewing one man in particular from Clare, and he had been an area police officer with the Republican police in Clare, a fellow called Bill Halloran. And he was, as he told me the story, he said, I was out delivering calves on my father's farm, and a man came out from headquarters and said, Collins wants you for a job above in Dublin. And he said, I had no idea what I was going to, but he said, I was given a ticket, and I took the train from Kilrush into Ennis, and I took a train from Ennis to Dublin, and two fellows met me at King's Bridge, and they told me I was in the Civic Guards. And he turned out to be an excellent guard, and I think he became a detective inspector eventually in the city centre. Are we on time? We're good.
Look, folks, that was a fantastic start today. I have to say, we could keep Conor here all day. As you say, Conor, I'd be happy to sign copies of Guardians of the Peace. And thank you all for coming along, and hope to see you at more events later on. But thanks very much to Conor.
Thanks, Brent. Thank you. Thanks, everybody.